Each of us has a rich liquid asset, which has been settled on every individual as a birthright. It's a priceless deposit which no single person can either spend or accumulate. It can only be lost or dispersed through injury or ill health. There are no plutocrats, only paupers. Poverty soon betrays itself when we look at those hidden corners where the blood runs close to the surface. These clinical glimpses can be misleading, though, and it may be necessary to withdraw a small amount of the patient's current account. Once this sample has been withdrawn, the audit can begin. If we stain a smear of blood, we can immediately see that it's not simply a sheet of colored cellophane, that there appear to be hundreds of particles. Now, this is the blood of a normal person. Now, let's compare it with the stained blood film from our anemic lady and see what it looks like. Well, as you can see, the picture is rather different. The colour is considerably less intense. Most of the cells seem much paler than usual. Now, that raises rather an interesting point. Is the paleness of the individual cells enough to explain the pallor of our patient's blood as a whole? Or are there also fewer cells than usual? In other words, are we actually looking at underpopulated blood? Well, presumably, in order to find out, we'd have to count the red cells and estimate what the population is. But you can't count them simply by looking at a film like this, since you've got no idea how much blood is on this slide. And what you have to do is to count the number of cells in a known small volume of blood. Now, that's easier said than done. A drop of blood can contain anything from 5 to 10, 15, 20 million cells. Now, what I'm going to do is I'm going to prick my finger. I'm going to suck up a known volume. I'm drawing it up to exactly 0.2 of a cubic millimeter, exactly up to the line. Now, even this small amount contains many more cells than I could comfortably count in a year, or a whole lifetime for that matter. So what I've got to do is to dilute this amount by squirting it into a large known volume of special fluid, which will keep all the cells intact and countable. Mix it up well so that the cells are evenly distributed throughout the whole of that known volume. All right. Now, I now take a small drop of this and infiltrate it onto a counting slide. I can start to look. Now, this slide has a specially engraved compartment whose volume has been calculated beforehand. It's exactly 1/400th of a cubic millimeter. Now, knowing the amount I've diluted the blood, knowing by how much I've reduced it in volume, I can obviously calculate the number of cells that are contained in 1 cubic millimeter of blood. Now, this technique that I'm using now is extremely old-fashioned. It's the one which I used when I worked in hospital many years ago, and now it's all done by machinery. But it makes the point much more clearly. So here we go. If I add up the cells square by square, I can work out that my blood contains roughly 5 million cells per cubic millimeter. This sort of analysis would have completely mystified the scientists of the 17th century. As far as they could see with the naked eye, blood was a simple, uniform red fluid. And even when the newly invented microscope showed that there were millions of particles floating in it, it was still more than 200 years before anyone recognized the need to classify, name, count, and measure them all. Now, to some extent, this was due to the poverty of the lenses. The earliest microscopes were so crude that they were almost incapable of resolving a clear or convincing image. As you can see, the image is so blurred that you could easily overlook the significance of these pink blobs. In fact, they don't even look like pink blobs at all. On the other hand, I don't want to give the impression that this oversight was simply a matter of bad optics, or that if a 17th century scientist had been given the chance of looking down a modern microscope instead of something like this, that he would automatically have made sense of the clear images he saw. Certainly, the images that you see down a modern microscope are wonderfully sharp, and when the film is carefully stained, as we've just done, well, all the cells seem to stand out quite unmistakably. But simply because an image is optically clear, it doesn't mean that its meaning is unmistakable. Seeing isn't simply a matter of visibility. In fact, if you know what you're looking for, you may be able to see it, even when the visibility is appalling. Here's an example of what I mean. A special computer has scrambled this image of a well-known face. If you screw up your eyes slightly, you'll probably recognize it as the Mona Lisa. And yet, to someone who's never seen Leonardo's well-known painting, this image would probably look like an anonymous lady, if it looked like a person at all. What you see depends to a very large extent on what you're already familiar with, as to say, on the sort of things that you expect to see in the world around you. In fact, here's another example. Now, for all practical purposes, this is a vase. That's what it was made to be, and that's how you'd see it, since vases are, after all, at least one of the things our sort of world is well known for. But if I alter the contrast like that, you may also be able to see two human profiles staring at one another. Now, suppose you came from Mars, though, a planet which is well known for being populated by faceless potters, featureless vase makers. Well, then you might look at this object until you were blue in the face, or at least what you like to call your face, and still see nothing but a vase. Well, it's just the same with a blood film. Unless you're already familiar with the notion of cells, as to say, unless you have good reason for knowing that the world is populated by such things as cells, you might not attach much importance to these blobs. You might see them as fat globules, for the simple reason that you've already met that sort of thing floating rather discouragingly on the surface of stew. But if you lived in a world all of which was made of perforated paper sheets, you might see this film as more of the same, as to say, as another sheet of perforated paper, punctured by holes through which you could just catch glimpses of a pink beyond. According to traditional theory, blood was a simple, uniform, irreducible substance. It was one of four primary physiological fluids which reproduced or duplicated the natural elements of the physical world. For more than 2,000 years, European scientists and philosophers had been enchanted by the Greek idea that the world was composed of four elementary substances. There was fire, air, earth, and water. By mixing these in various proportions and combinations, you could arrive at any of the known forms of matter. Rather like a skilled painter who, by playing with the three primary colors, can paint anything he likes. In antiquity, these primary colors or elements were matched by physiological humors in the human body, which reproduced the properties of the physical elements. Elemental fire
was represented by the physiological substance called yellow bile. Earth took the form of black bile, which was known as melancholy. Water was reproduced in the form of phlegm. And for reasons which we find hard to understand, the invisible element of air corresponded to the blood. Ideally, the four humours were present in equal amounts. In ordinary mortals, though, one or other humour tended to predominate. Such excess could lead to melancholy, anger or choler, phlegmatic complacency, or in the special case of blood, the sanguine temperament, which was looked on with special favour. And because of this, when artists wanted to represent the supernatural health and vitality of God, they sometimes showed him with a ruddy complexion. So it's not surprising that when William Harvey came to consider the matter in the 17th century, he more or less disregarded the other three humours. In fact, he actually poked fun at the traditional notion of four humours, insisting that blood alone was the sovereign principle of life.
It is unquestionable and obvious to sense that blood is the first engendered part whence the living principle in the first instance gleams forth. We conclude that blood lives of itself and that it depends in no wise upon any other part of the body. Blood is the cause not only of life in general, but also of longer or shorter life, of sleep and of watching, of genius, aptitude, and strength. It is the first to live and the last to die.
He arrived at this conclusion by looking at the developing chick and mistook this pulsation for some innate liveliness in the blood itself. For Harvey, blood was a uniform substance. A few years later, though, microscopes showed that the situation was considerably more complicated than he supposed, and that blood could be resolved into parts. Even so, such a texture would have been no more remarkable than finding that this wall was made of separate bricks. Or discovering that a medieval face in a tapestry was made out of separate stitches. Or that a Roman mosaic was made out of pieces of tile. Or that an image on a modern film is made up of grain. But when a modern biologist looks at a microscope slide, he sees it in a different way altogether. He regards living organisms, man included, as a republic of cells. That's to say, as an orderly multitude of separate living individuals, which assume the form of a single person. This concept had been applied to human society by the English philosopher Hobbes when he described it as a huge leviathan, composed not of particles, but of living individuals. And this was the very idea which his scientific contemporaries had failed to appreciate in pictures like these. 200 years later, though, in 1858, the great German pathologist Virchow addressed his public in the following words.
The structural composition of any living body of considerable size, a so-called individual, always represents an arrangement of a social kind, in which a number of individual existences are mutually dependent, but in such a way that every element has its special action.
In fact, by the end of the 19th century, it was generally agreed that the ultimate constituent of all living matter was something called the cell. This is a large, rather crude model of a red blood cell. Now, what made this entity different from all the other blobs, globules, granules, and particles that have been seen so far was the fact that each one had a living biography. And perhaps even more important, each one had a family tree. So that the objects on a microscope slide are related to one another, not like bricks or pots which have been molded from the same piece of clay and then fired together in the same kiln, but much more like brothers and sisters who share the same parents and descend from the same ancestors. So that to all intents and purposes, microscope slides like the ones we've seen are really group photographs, anniversary tableaus which show in the same frame brothers, sisters and cousins, some old and some young. However, unlike an ordinary family photograph, the parents, the ancestors, are conspicuous by their absence.
To explain this, we must ask some more questions about the functions of blood and why it's red. These people have been dancing without a break for 6 hours. 3 minutes after I joined in, however, I was brought to my knees gasping for breath. These people obviously had something which I hadn't got. The Bolivian city of La Paz has a population of nearly 1 million people who have all learnt to live quite comfortably at an altitude of more than 13,000 feet. Even aircraft have to run flat out for nearly 2 miles at this height before they can take off. Seeing these people exerting themselves without any apparent signs of discomfort, one's tempted to think that their ability to survive the thin atmosphere at these heights is the result of some racial endowment, and that natural selection has favored a group who have a less intense need for air than everyone else. However, this can't be the case, since even the visitor gradually becomes acclimatized, and after 6 months, his exercise tolerance approaches, even if it never actually reaches, that of the native population. All this must mean that living at such heights causes a physiological change in the body. And since the need for oxygen is invariable, one can only assume that the high standard of the Bolivian performance and the improvement in the Europeans is the result of an increased ability to obtain what little oxygen there is. Even their sporting activities are carried out with an enthusiasm which would leave most Europeans panting at sea level. The secret lies in the blood, since this is the substance that carries oxygen to the working tissues, and its mysterious power to do this depends on its redness. The color of blood is due to a special pigment which is only found in the red cells. It's called hemoglobin. A model of hemoglobin looks something like this, but unless one knows exactly what sort of model it is, it's impossible to understand what it represents. So, if you'll excuse me, a brief digression on models. Now, this is a model of a steam locomotive. In fact, the only way in which it differs from a real one is that it's 25 times smaller. It looks the same, its proportions are the same, And as you've already seen, it even works like the real thing. Here's a model at the other extreme, 36 times larger than the swattable object it represents. All the same, it has a startling visual resemblance to a fly. Even the colors have been painstakingly reproduced. But this visual model making only works up to a point. Here's the model of the red cell again. It's also to scale, although it's not quite so easy to recognize the visual resemblance this time, since the object which it represents is much too small to be seen with the naked eye. All the same, if you were to look at a red cell through a very powerful microscope, you'd see that this model was a fairly accurate representation of its shape, at least. That's to say, you'd see that, like this object here, the red cell was also slightly hollow on each side. But in one respect, however, the appearance of the model is quite misleading. For although blood as a whole is red, that doesn't mean that the individual cells are. As we've already seen, it's hardly red at all. In fact, strictly speaking, it's a red blood cell with the red in inverted commas. All the same, once you make that allowance, you can still regard a model of this sort as a pictorial one, exactly like the locomotive and the fly. But strictly speaking, it's not necessary for something to be visible before you can make a visible model of it. It all depends on what you want to use your model for. You see, some models are used simply to find your way around, and no one pretends that they have to be portraits or pictures of what they represent in order to do that. For example, who's ever seen the layout of the London Underground? It's not surprising, because it's underground. And the map in the train is not even meant to be a picture of it. As long as you can see that Piccadilly Circus is marked on the map between Green Park on the one hand and Leicester Square on the other, then the model of the underground system fulfills its purpose. Now, although this is a representation of a hemoglobin molecule, it's a logical one rather than a pictorial one. It's not meant to tell you what the molecule actually looks like, because, strictly speaking, the molecule itself hasn't got a look, because there's no way in which it can be seen. As in the tube map, all that you can tell from these beads here is how the atoms are arranged in space in relationship to one another. And that's been found not from looking at the molecule, but from doing mathematical calculations on the images which result from firing X-rays at it. There are no red, black, or green blobs in the molecule itself. In fact, the model would be just as accurate if the beads were yellow, orange, or sky blue, as long as you could distinguish which ones represented oxygen and which ones represented hydrogen, nitrogen, and carbon, and so forth. And that's done by an international convention or a color code. So what can we learn from this model? Well, most of it is simply a large clump of protein which has been rolled up into a ball, which is called a globulin. You can think of it as a biochemical anchorage. But the interesting part is this ring of green pentagons grouped around the red ball at the center. This part is called the heme section. It's made up of a ring of rings, which is called a porphyrin. It's really that part of the molecule which gives the hemoglobin as a whole its color, and above all, its physiological function. Suspended at the center of this ring of rings, there's an atom of iron. Now, when iron comes into contact with a porphyrin molecule, the substance as a whole shows a peculiar affinity for oxygen. In fact, it binds it in a loose chemical combination. Well, it's rather fortunate for our purposes that the combination is as loose as it is, because if the hemoglobin seized the oxygen and never let go of it, well, there wouldn't be much point. There's no use having blood loaded with oxygen if the tissues can't grab hold of the oxygen in their turn. So what happens is this. When the hemoglobin comes into contact with a high concentration of oxygen in the lungs, it immediately combines with it. And that's when the switch from purple to scarlet happens. But as the blood leaves the lungs and begins to circulate through the tissues, it, of course, enters an atmosphere where the oxygen all around it is relatively low in concentration because it's being used up. Now, when that happens, the oxygen in the hemoglobin loosens its attachment, passes out of the red cell, through the plasma, and into the tissues which can use it. If we take blood and spin it in a centrifuge, the cells will be flung to the bottom of the tube and separated from the watery plasma. In normal blood, the proportion's about half and half. But if we compare it to the blood of someone who's lived for a long time at high altitude, on the right we can just see that there is a higher proportion of red cells. But where do all these extra cells come from?
This is the thigh bone of a cow. Now, in order to economize on the use of materials, to keep the mechanics of the bone as light as possible, the vertebrates have evolved hollow bones with all the structural elements concentrated around the edge, on the outside. In the middle of the bone, though, the hollow space is occupied by red marrow. This is the nursery of the blood, and this is where we'll find our long-lost parents. Unlike a human parent, though, which only produces a few offspring in its life, this continues to produce them. These, in turn, divide and multiply further. It goes something like this. The stem cell buds off an offspring. This splits into two, and each of these split again, and so on, and so on. With each division, the cells grow pinker as they're loaded with more and more hemoglobin. By the time they pass through several of these multiplications, they start to lose their nucleus and become quite red. They're now ready to be enrolled as fully fledged members of the strolling institution of the bloodstream. At this stage, we can think of them as a fleet of motor cars. And as we'll see, the analogy is amazingly close. The red cells spend their active life cruising through the highways of the circulation. But it's not simply an idle joyride, because the red cells are small commercial vehicles transporting their precious cargo of oxygen from lungs to tissues. Like motor cars, though, they wear out, they begin to falter and have to be replaced. Their useful lifespan is only about 120 days, after which they become fragile and inefficient. But the derelict blood cells can't be left abandoned on the curbside in the busy bloodstream, as this would lead to a pileup or a thrombosis. Old red cells are retrieved by breaker's yards in the liver and in the spleen. Here, special cells smash up the coachwork and recover and recycle scarce components like iron. Some parts, though, are not reusable, and since the components from which they're made are always in plentiful supply, they can be disposed of. But there has to be a tip somewhere in which to dump them. The pigment, which is left over after the hemoglobin has been stripped of its iron, is dumped in the gallbladder as green bile. Under normal circumstances, the bloodstream loses red cells at the rate of 1 million every day,
And to keep the blood count at a steady level, the red cell production line has to manufacture new ones at the same rate. In the factory, or the bone marrow, all the cells are fitted with the biochemical working parts which will keep them roadworthy and efficient during their short, useful life in the bloodstream. Unlike a car, which needs its engine to move it about, the machinery which is fitted to the red cell is entirely devoted to the task of obtaining, holding, and unloading oxygen, since the motive power is provided by the heart. Some of the machinery in a red cell is needed simply to help it maintain its shape. Cars owe their shape to the rigid coachwork. Red cells, though, have a floppy envelope which can only be held in place at the expense of unremitting biochemical work. Naturally, this biographical process can be interrupted, thwarted, or shortened at any point along the line. First of all, new cells may simply fail to make their appearance altogether. Secondly, they may appear, but they may be faulty or badly manufactured. And finally, once in the circulation, their life may be unnaturally shortened, either because they are badly manufactured, or else because the road conditions are pathologically unfavorable. Now, let's consider simplified examples of each one. First of all, the whole production process may simply fail right at the very outset. It's as if this factory here had been sabotaged, wiped out, or else had gone on strike. You see, if the stem cells are blasted by atomic radiation, say, or industrial poisons, or by the indiscriminate use of certain drugs, the rate of production may no longer be enough to replenish the natural losses. It's as if the factory could only turn out a couple of substandard cars every day. Now, when this happens to a person, he begins to suffer from something called aplastic anemia. The highways of his circulation gradually empty of red cells as the old ones vanish and die off. The normal productivity of the bone marrow is so efficient that it can easily turn out millions of extra blood cells whenever the need arises, and that's what happens at high altitude. The low atmospheric oxygen acts as a stimulus to the bone marrow's industrial management, and red cells are manufactured so that the blood will be able to snatch more of what little oxygen there is. But the whole process may falter at the next stage. The cells may fail to mature properly, either as a result of faults in the inherited instructions or for want of essential components like iron, say. In a car factory, the management has to test the vehicles before they're released and are prevented from allowing faulty vehicles onto the road. The bone marrow, however, struggles on regardless, and faulty, inefficient cells start to appear in the circulation. As these replace the old ones, the whole population gradually takes a turn for the worse. This is the tail of a small fish under the microscope, and it's possible to see the circulation with cells streaming along like city traffic. It's here, in the blood vessels, that damage can occur, either because the cells are badly made and simply fall to bits too early, or because they're exposed to unexpected risks in the plasma. We can actually see this by exposing red cells to an unfavorable chemical environment. They seem to vanish without trace. The point is that if the delicate balance of the red cell's environment is upset, their disc-shaped envelope can't sustain itself. It goes spherical and then disappears. This inevitably leads to a recognizable anemia. If a mother happens to conceive a child whose red blood cells are incompatible with her own due to the presence of something called the rhesus factor in the red cells of the child, she may begin to produce antibodies which injure her baby's red cells. Throughout pregnancy, she begins to produce these antibodies in her own bloodstream. They float through the placenta, enter the bloodstream of the unborn infant, and start to pop its red cells faster than the child can make them. This brings about the picture known as hemolytic anemia of the newborn. It has two important aspects. First of all, the child is born anemic with a low blood count, and secondly, it's jaundice.
It's a 24-weeker, this one, Jim.
Yeah.
Oh, there it is.
Oh, that's it.
These days, rhesus incompatibility can be spotted in the very early stages of pregnancy, and an elaborate operation has been devised to supply the baby with the right type of blood while it's still in the womb.
Oh, there it is, at the top.
Just that?
Yes.
With X-rays, the doctors identify the exact position of the child in the womb. And there's an interesting point here which takes me back to the Mona Lisa earlier in the program. A picture like this seems to convey no information at all, and it's only by knowing what there is that what is seen makes sense at all. Because the catheter will eventually have to hit a three-dimensional target deep inside the womb, pictures have to be taken at various angles.
There's the fan. Coming right across, I thought.
Yeah. Yeah, it's not laggy.
And there's the other one down
the bottom there.
So if we go in between those two about there, we should be plumb right.
Yes.
Okay.
Mark up, please.
The entry point is marked.
I'll go and scrub.
These days, operations like this are becoming quite rare because the hematologists now have a way of extinguishing the maternal antibodies before they have a chance to enter the baby's bloodstream. The hollow guide goes through the mother's abdominal wall, into the womb, and pierces the baby's abdomen.
Should be.
Could be in.
Or back. I don't know. Do you want to look first?
I want to just suck up first. Try it, Jim. Just have a look, shall we, first, okay. Before I put the catheter in.
Its progress is checked on X-ray. Now the doctors know the needle's in place, the flexible catheter can be fed into the child's circulation.
Running?
I think I may have gone too deep. That's better,
Running?
Yes. Right, do you want to screen for me, please?
Yep, Jim. Right, there, pal.
Dye going in. That's in. What's that?
What? Huh?
Oh, that's my needle. That's all right.
Everything seems to be in place, so the transfusion can start.
Doctor, could you order the blood now, please? Mrs. Ferguson, we've got into the baby now. We're just waiting for the blood to come up. All right?
We won't be long now.
Millions of red cells of the mother's type, rhesus negative, are gradually introduced into the baby's body where they'll be absorbed into the bloodstream, making up for the baby's own cells which have been destroyed. This vital transfusion helps the baby to survive a few more weeks in the womb until it is mature enough to live outside. Even then, even after birth, the baby is still likely to need a total exchange of blood, with its own circulation being removed and replaced with healthy blood. All this would be quite impossible unless we knew that blood was made of living cells, and that cells have a biochemical complexion which puts them at risk if they're mixed with any group other than their own. Early attempts to transfuse this life-giving substance often had the opposite effect. Nowadays, hematologists know that it's not only unsafe to transfuse animals' blood to men, but that the existence of distinct blood groups in humans means that there's even a limit to the number of people from whom any one person can safely receive blood. Someone whose blood cells are group A can't give blood to someone of group B because the recipient has antibodies which will attack the new blood and the breakdown products will block the kidneys. So, before a transfusion can take place, the blood groups of donor and recipient have to be carefully checked and directly cross-matched against one another. In the old days, all these tests had to be done by hand. I can still remember staying up all night to do them in the lab. Nowadays, hundreds of samples can be tested automatically in an hour. This elaborate technology has introduced the possibility of a totally new circulation of the blood. Like a hard currency, human blood now circulates not simply within the body of a living individual, but from person to person. This wealth is shared, or at least it should be. What blood each of us has, we hold on trust. We're free to use it as long as we live. But since we also expect to receive it when we're in need, then we are honor bound to open this personal account to an infinite number of anonymous others. Well, some years ago, the British sociologist Richard Titmuss recognized that there was a striking resemblance between this relationship and certain rather peculiar rituals which had long been known to exist in primitive communities. In the Trobriand Islands of the South Seas, for instance, a stock of cowrie shells circulates endlessly around the Polynesian archipelago. Now, the shells themselves have got no intrinsic value. In fact, like blood, they're only valuable as long as they're kept on the move. To receive such a shell is to automatically recognize the obligation to hand it on. And that, in turn, puts you in a position to receive another one, and so on, and so on. You can't hoard the shells, and it's regarded as the height of bad manners to exchange one of them for a useful commodity such as food. Well, this apparently useless circulation forges a chain of mutual obligation, and that, in turn, helps to create and constitute the Trobriand society or community. Well, it's easy to see how this principle applies to blood, especially since blood helps to maintain life. The free exchange of blood also maintains bonds of mutual affinity and responsibility, and these override any conflict of race, religion, or nationality. In fact, it helps to seal or confirm the indivisible organic unity of the human species. It's easy for any healthy person to spare a pint of blood. The difficulty is that serious injury or massive operations often put one in need of a great deal more. And that means that the exchange cannot take place on a personal level. The whole enterprise depends on establishing a public account, one which is large enough to meet all the chronic expenditures, plus, of course, any of the emergencies which might happen in any given year. So blood transfusion centers like this represent the outcome, the interplay of elaborate social administration, plus, of course, the most advanced technological research. You see, in addition to the blood which is flowing in and out of the current account every day, the perfection of deep freezing techniques like this allowed us to establish a deposit account, which I suppose is rather like the bullion room at Fort Knox. Now, one of the advantages of this is that it allows us to store rare blood groups almost indefinitely, whereas previously there had to be a sort of worldwide index of standby contributors or donors who were on alert 24 hours a day. So that blood can now move freely, not simply from you to me and vice versa, but from all of us to our great-great-great-grandchildren and perhaps even further, thus establishing a sort of four-dimensional blood brotherhood which extends not simply horizontally in space, but vertically in time. Unlike a bank, though, the whole arrangement works best when the deposits are made in the form of a free gift, without any reward, over and above the knowledge that one's rights of withdrawal are unlimited. Naturally, this leaves loopholes for free riders. That's to say, it's not like a system of compulsory taxation. Everybody doesn't have to contribute. The whole enterprise relies on the assumption that there will always be enough people prompted by altruistic motives to keep the account solvent. This new circulation of the blood is so important that most modern medicine and nearly all surgery would come to a standstill without it. Our understanding of blood has transformed the prospects of human life.
We conclude that blood lives of itself and that it depends in no wise upon any other part of the body. Blood is the cause not only of life in general, but also of longer or shorter life, of sleep and of watching, of genius, aptitude, and strength. It is the first to live and the last to die.